Congress.
Welcome. Thank you all for coming to the forum for this panel this evening on a great and important man, Ronald Reagan. This is an all-star team that Harvard has assembled. So I'm Mark Halperin of Time Magazine, and I'm going to do my best to stay out of the way and let these four people talk. This is an opportunity for people who didn't know President Reagan to hear from four people who did, and Mrs. Reagan. I'm going to try to get a sense of the audience, so I'm going to ask you all to vote by show of hands, and if you're uncomfortable voting in front of others, close your eyes as you vote. raise your hand if you, besides the four here, if you ever met President or Mrs. Reagan, raise your hand. All right.
Raise your hand if you were alive when he was president. All right. Yay!
I was an undergraduate here during my entire time here during the Reagan presidency. So he was the last president I didn't cover as a professional journalist, and I've met every president since then, but I have never met President Reagan. I've met Mrs. Reagan. I was fortunate enough to be invited to an event at the Reagan Library last year, and for the first time got to meet her and spend some time with her. But for me, this is the same treat that I hope you all find it to be, which is a chance to hear from people who can bring to life President Reagan in this important year, and to tell stories about him in a way that will try to give you a sense of why he was such an important and historic figure and such an impressive man. I want to mention two people very briefly who recently passed away, who had ties to both Harvard and to President Reagan. One is David Broder. I think this is probably one of the first public events here since David Broder, the Washington Post, Lou's longtime colleague, passed away. David is a former fellow at the Institute of Politics and covered President Reagan, as he did presidents for a very long time. So I wanted to mention David and talk and the fact that all of us are thinking about him. The other person I want to mention is Reverend Peter Gomes, who died just 10 days ago, I think, and who took a little flack in what he always referred to as the People's Republic of Cambridge for speaking at President Reagan's, they were doing the benediction of President Reagan's second inaugural. When Reverend Gomes was asked, why'd you do it? He said, well, he did take a lot of heat. But when people said, why were you willing to pray for Ronald Reagan? He said, think how bad things would have been if I hadn't done it. That is very much in the spirit of
that's why the inaugural was inside.
Exactly.
Not outside.
That very much in the spirit of Reverend Gomes, and again, I wanted to note his passing and the fact that we're all thinking about him. So let me now introduce the panel and get them talking about President Reagan, and I'll just introduce them briefly because I know you all have internet access, and if you want to read their full biographies, you can. Start with on the end with Professor Roger Porter, who worked in the Reagan administration, chief of domestic policy, and is now, of course, a professor here at Harvard. All these people also work for other Republican presidents, including Professor Porter. Next, Lou Cannon, longtime Washington Post reporter who wrote many books about President Reagan, including one that the current president was recently spotted reading, thanks maybe to Ken Duberstein. And Lou is really, you don't have anyone today, or for the last several presidents really, with the stature of Lou. Lou was considered as someone who covered the White House for the Washington Post and wrote so frequently about President Reagan, and with his deep ties to California, had a relationship, professional relationship with President Reagan and the Reagan presidency that was dominant and, again, unmatched by anybody covering this White House or any White House since then. Next, Sheila Tate, who worked with Mrs. Reagan as the White House press secretary and who now works as the vice chairman of Powell Tate Public Relations, with a long experience working with lots of different people, but her time with Mrs. Reagan, I think it's safe to say, was probably your most high-profile position as a spokesperson for someone in public life as a first lady. And then finally, Ken Duberstein, who's on the board here at the Institute of Politics and served as President Reagan's chief of staff during the last 2 years of his time in office. So again, these are people with so much deep knowledge. I want to just get them talking to try to understand as best we can both President Reagan and the times in which he governed and lived. And let me start, Lou, with you and ask you to tell people, again, all you've written about the president, tell people what you think the essence of President Reagan was, that particularly younger people here who have no real sense of him, what's the essence of him that made him a distinctive leader?
It's It's not easy to distill in a few words. Ronald Reagan was asked at the on the eve of his election to the presidency in 1980 by a radio reporter, what is it that people see in you? And he said, would you laugh if I said that people see me as one of them, and that I've never been able to think about myself as being apart from them? Walter Lippmann famously wrote that the greatness of de Gaulle was not that he was in France, but that France was in de Gaulle. And I think the greatness of Reagan was that America was inside him. Ronald Reagan is an elusive person in American history. The silliest thing that has ever been written about him, and I probably contributed my share to that, was what you see is what you get, because what you got in Reagan was a lot more than what you saw. There was a deep, abiding faith in country. There was this enormous love he had for Nancy Reagan. I think there was a spiritual quality to Reagan, although he was very conscious of not wanting to wear it on his sleeve. He wasn't one of these people who liked to go to church in public. And there was this wonderful, abiding sense of humor that connected him with people. You know, what kind of a governor will you be? I don't know. I've never played a governor. I figured nobody ever, he said, I know no one ever died of hard work, but I figured, why take the chance? Now, Ronald Reagan, the thing that when we started covering him in the 60s, we thought other people were writing the one-liners for him. And that was the first thing in which I was disabused. And I'll just stop with this one more because you could go on for a very long time. But in the 1966 gubernatorial campaign, where Reagan's opponent, Governor Pat Brown, who had been a good governor of California, who had kind of worn out his welcome, Pat loved to say that he'd been doing great things for the state of California while Ronald Reagan was being upstaged by a chimpanzee in the movie Bedtime for Bonzo. So an AP reporter named Doug Willis got a studio picture of Reagan and Bonzo and brought it to Reagan to autograph, and Reagan cheerfully autographed it, and underneath his autograph he wrote, "I'm the one with the watch."
Professor Porter, one of the things that was said about President Reagan during his presidency, including by a lot of people here in the People's Republic of Cambridge, was that he was not well-versed in policy, that he was divorced from the details of the office, and that caused him to pursue policies that weren't rigorous and well thought out. What's your view of that from having worked with him on policy?
That was a very commonly held belief, and a belief that was sustained for a fairly long period of time by many people who I think didn't get a chance to spend around him. What I discovered, somewhat to my surprise, because I had only met him on one occasion before I went to work for him in January of 1981, when he very first came in, was that he would read everything you sent him. And he had an incredible memory. I mean, he could remember the facts of what we're in. And that if he didn't understand something to his satisfaction, he would ask about it and get it clear in his mind. And he was quite comfortable in dealing with a whole range of issues at the level of what is it that we should do and what is the right thing to do. I never got the impression that he thought a lot about the political calculations of how this might affect him electorally. But he thought a lot about how am I going to get this accomplished? Because he'd spent, well, Lou knows this better than anyone, he'd spent his entire governorship in California dealing with a Democratic legislature. And so when he had to deal, and Ken knows a lot about this because you started out in the Office of Legislative Affairs, he had to deal with a Democratic House, and in the last 2 years, a Democratic Senate as well. And so he was comfortable in trying to figure out what is it that we need to do to get this accomplished. But the idea that he was disengaged from policy was one that I found in practice was not, in fact,
where did it come from?
I remember
it was
Mike
in Time magazine.
Yeah, it could have been.
As long as it wasn't human events.
I remember Mike Deaver coming into a senior staff meeting one day, and the president had been up till 3 o'clock in the morning reading all the material that had been sent him last night. And obviously, Mrs. Reagan had discovered this and was very unhappy about it and passed it along to Mike. And Mike rarely said anything in senior staff meeting. I mean, Ken, I don't know if you can remember. I don't remember him ever speaking more than on two or three occasions. But we got near the end of the senior staff meeting, and Jim Baker, who was chairing it, said, Mike has something he'd like to say. This is kind of this chill went through the audience, and he said, the president was up until 3 o'clock this morning reading all the papers that you people sent him. You see, he believes if you think it's important enough to send him, it's important enough for him to read it and understand it. And everybody was looking around like, how many papers did I send in last night and how long were they and et cetera. And he said, you know, he has 14 meetings on his schedule today. It's not fair to him. It's not fair to the people whom he's going to be meeting with. So we've got to get this under control. And that's when it sort of dawned on me that Reagan saw the job as, if these people think it's important enough to send, I am going to do it. And so he was a very diligent reader. Can you?
Let me add on a few things. Ronald Reagan was always very comfortable in his own skin. People could take shots at him. Lou could write a critical article, and he would just rub right off. He knew why he wanted to run for president. He knew what he would do when he became president, and he went about trying to get that done. George Herbert Walker Bush, yesterday, in a salute to Ronald Reagan, talked about Ronald Reagan as the ultimate pragmatist who understood my words, not President Bush's words, that progress is in bite-sized pieces and not in Hail Marys. And so Ronald Reagan always tried to figure out is how I could advance the ball down the field. Tip O'Neill used to say, I don't like compromising with Ronald Reagan because every time I compromise with him, President Reagan gets 80% of what he wants. And President Reagan would say to Baker and Deaver and myself and others, I'll take 80% every time and come back the next year for the additional 20. That's the art of governing, which Reagan understood absolutely.
Mark, just briefly, because I don't want to take Sheila or Tenney's time, but I think there's this great writer of another era, Douglas Cater, who wrote The Fourth Branch of Government, which I think up here probably have read. I hope some of you read it if you haven't. And Doug wrote a novel. It wasn't a successful novel, but it was. He had some wonderful stuff in it. And one of the characters in the novel says, you get a reputation when you come to Washington. You know, you're lazy, you're hardworking, you're liberal, you're conservative, you're honest, you're a womanizer, whatever. And all the hounds of heaven and hell can't shake that reputation. Ronald Reagan was tagged deliberately when he ran for governor. The campaign against him was, it had what the social scientists would say, cognitive dissonance. On the one hand, he was this dangerous extremist. On the other hand, he was this empty-headed actor. And an actor was used as a synonym for airhead. It was a very bad campaign thing in California where for better or not, maybe we're all airheads, but we think highly of actors. And so Ronald Reagan essentially had that, in a sense, I hate to say it, that after all he achieved, that has never completely left. It's Reagan the actor. I deliberately chose the words, the role of a lifetime, as a subtitle for my book, because I knew how much Ronald Reagan valued being an actor. Some people thought it was a put-down. He didn't, and it certainly wasn't meant to be.
Before I jump, let me just jump in for 1 second. At the end of the presidency, the day before the end of January 20th, January 19th, we had a farewell for him in the East Room of the White House with all the White House staff. And I emceed it, and in part of my remarks, I said, Mr. President, you started out to change the country, and you wound up changing the world. And Reagan, in response, said, not bad for a B-movie actor from California. And everybody just busted up. There's the humor. There's the self-deprecation. And there is,
and there's he's the one pride, of us. Pride in his craft.
Exactly right.
Well, Sheila, I want to ask you about the media environment in which the Reagans had to operate, much different than the one we have today, not the 24/7 news cycle, but still unrelenting interest, as there always is in our first couples. What was the Reagans' posture towards that relentless pressure from the media? What was their attitude towards the kind of coverage they got?
Well, first of all, it was the... We were right on the cusp of the 24/7. CNN started in 81. And in fact, I spent a lot of my time dealing with the other networks not wanting CNN to be in the pools. And that was one of the issues. But you're right. I mean, we didn't have the internet. We didn't have bloggers. We didn't have all the things that are going on today. And so you had time. But the Reagan's attitude. Let's see. Nancy Reagan cared a lot about what was written about her. And what she said to me was, I will always be available to you, which is, I mean, a press secretary can't ask for more than, you know, having a boss who will answer your call, even if you call 7 or 8 times a day. And sometimes I had to. She said, I'd rather that than be surprised at something. I want to know. And she had pretty good instincts. She, if she was going to do something and the counsel was, this is not going to go over well in the press, her attitude to that was, it's worth it to me. You know, I'm going to redecorate the White House with private funds because it's in terrible shape. It needs it. It's a historic home, and I'm going to do it, and I'll take the heat. That was one of our first issues. I'm going to order China. She didn't know it was going to be unveiled to the press, well, it was leaked to the press, on the day that the Department of Agriculture declared ketchup a vegetable in the school lunch program. And the editorial coverage was just brutal on that subject. But even, you know, Ronald Reagan, talking about his ability to communicate and his ability to really get to the heart of the matter and to really understand. I was struggling with this, I mean, White House China issue. He finally went before a news conference and he said, and all these people attacking Nancy for these dishes. Oh, why didn't I think of using that word? That's what, they're dishes. They're not China, they're dishes. And it was funny how that story just sort of faded away.
A case not of any preparation or the staff giving
it was line. It was an instant, honest appraisal of him, right. You know, on his part of what this issue was.
Right. Lou, a lot of the coverage on this anniversary of the president's has focused on his time in the White House. But talk a bit about his time as California governor and how that informed his attitude about how to do the job of president, about the way to work with the legislature, the way to deal with the press, all the challenges of being president.
I will do that, and I hope I'm not being disrespectful to you, Mark, to add on to what Sheila said. Sheila was a very, very good press secretary, and she was very good for Nancy Reagan. She was very good for George H.W. Bush. She was very highly respected among reporters, and I think somebody ought to say that. So I just did.
Thank you.
But I remember this. You know how you remember some things. Yeah, when you get to be my age, you can't remember what you had for breakfast, but you can remember some things that happened a long time ago. This was in the 76 campaign, and Reagan was running for the nomination, and Ford ultimately won. And we were in Shreveport, Louisiana, and Reagan was doing a series of very quick interviews with all the members of the traveling press corps. And so I did mine, and I remember Lynn Nofsinger was with him, and I'm starting to leave the room, and Reagan said, "Lou, can I ask you something?" And I said, "Sure, Governor." We called him Governor till the day he became president. And he said, "There's this column that was in the Washington Star, which was then a competitive paper, and it was written by a woman whose name was Judy Backrack, and it made fun of Nancy Reagan's legs."
Right.
It was a nasty column, and it was, but on that same day, in the same paper, there were about 7 columns saying Reagan didn't know important parts of his anatomy from a hot rock, that he was wrong about this, that he was wrong about that. And Reagan didn't care about any of it. All he cared about, he said, "Why would anybody write that?" She said, "You know, crying up all night." She said, "You know how it is if you're a husband. I mean, why would somebody write that about your wife?" He was just so wonderful. And I happened to know by a total coincidence, because I had a column, and she happened to be, like, she had 8 places that were syndicated. She happened to be in next to last in the bottom of the syndicated column. And I said, and I told him that. And I said, I just happened to know this, Governor. "Oh, good," he said, "I'll tell her that." and it was so wonderful. He was really being, some of you, my wife's program, favorite television program of mine, are The Good Wife. We watched, well, he was being the good husband. California helped him in almost any conceivable way. When I wrote about the book that was the television people would call it a prequel, because it was Governor Reagan, the one thing that everybody agreed about who had worked for Reagan, and I mean everyone, Ed Meese and Bill Clark and people who, other people who didn't agree with each other, Cap Weinberger, they all agreed that he wouldn't have been able to be the president he was without being governor of California. And Reagan went further. He said to me, "I don't know if I could have been president without being governor of California." He came in at a time where California had a lot of the things he'd face in Washington. It had a deficit. It had a very, very highly articulate, able civil service that was not going to give any new governor, Reagan or anybody else, a slack. It had a Democratic majority with Jess Unruh as the leader, one of the finest Democratic state legislative leaders, I shouldn't say Democratic, state legislative leaders there's ever been. It had a fractious Senate with people all over them. It was a mirror. It was kind of a, if you were writing this as a fiction and you were foreshadowing it, as a novelist would do, you'd say, well, you're relying too much on coincidence. And Ronald Reagan had a hard time being governor of California. He learned. He was a much better governor of California in his second term than he was in his first term. So Ronald Reagan had been through an awful lot. And when Tip O'Neill, and Kenny, remember this, I think it was one of the most revealing things that Reagan ever said to me. I think it was December of 80. He'd been elected. They came back to Washington. They met with Tip O'Neill, and Tip was a House Speaker, and Tip liked to pull people's chain. And he said, "Well," he said, "you've been governor of California. That's the Bush leagues. This is the major leagues." All the people who were there with Reagan, even including Mike, were kind of furious with O'Neill afterwards. They thought, "Well, this was being very disrespectful to the guys that's been elected president of the United States." And I asked Reagan about it. Reagan was sort of happy about it. He said, "I don't think it's a disadvantage to be underestimated by the Speaker of the House."
Absolutely.
And I always thought, this is the telltale story. Reagan has an idea of what he wants to do in office, and like all presidents, some of it he was able to do and some he wasn't. But he had a basis, the superstructure under this big tanker, you know, that was coming in there, was the governorship of California, and he really had learned from it.
2 weeks ago, I did a panel on the Reagan 100th birthday with Tom Brokaw, who said, Duberstein, you may have been good in the White House, but the reason you succeeded legislatively, because Reagan learned how to deal with the legislature in California.
Right.
He understood that meeting that Lou just talked about, where Tip dissed him, my word.
Not Tip.
And one of the things that we did right after that is set out to go visit 435 House offices, to knock on doors, to get to know people on the Hill. And this was during transition. This is before we moved into the White House on January 20th, to start building the kind of relationships so we knew who we could go to when we were putting together the coalition on taxes and spending, because we knew where the votes were and we knew where the districts were that Reagan was strongest in. But it all started with Reagan's understanding from California and how do you deal with the legislature. It goes back to the fundamental point that Ronald Reagan understood, which is that in order to win, it's not building a consensus in Washington, it's building a consensus in the country, and Washington will follow. That's what he was about.
But he also had this capacity to relate to the people whom he was dealing with. I remember once coming through the West Lobby, which is where people would sit on the couches before they were going to go in for a meeting with the president. There was a Democratic member of the House there. And I went over and shook his hand and said, what are you doing down here? And he said, you know, I'm going in to meet with the president. I don't expect that I'll ever vote for anything that you guys send up. But, and this was 3.5 months into the administration, but he said, I never met President Carter during my first 2 years in the House. And he said, I'll never forget this. I may never vote with you, but I'll never forget it. Well, he didn't vote with us, but he happened to be a subcommittee chair who was in the position to block a lot of things if he wanted to. And because of the relationship that he established with President Reagan, he helped facilitate things from happening, even though on a floor vote he was not going to be out there voting. And Reagan had this capacity to connect with people, even who disagreed with him on policy.
I got a great story that is just like that, same point. When the Reagan's daughter Patty was getting married, his parents, they were from Montana, and his parents were meeting the President of the United States and the First Lady at the Bel Air Hotel the day before, in the week, just a few days before the wedding, first time they'd ever met him. And I saw them walking in, and these are, you know, really salt of the earth people. And I stood there looking, and I kept thinking, what must it be like to be in this position? Your son's about to marry the daughter of the president, and you're about to meet him, and you've never been to California. Within 5 minutes, I noticed the mother and the father and another woman standing in a semicircle around the president. So I went over to see what was going on, and he had taken his new hearing aids out, and he had them in his hand. And he was telling them the benefits of these new hearing aids. And then one woman said, we have got to tell Aunt so-and-so about this. I mean, it was like they had known them forever. And Ronald Reagan could do that with anybody. I've seen it. He did it with Chris Matthews, for God's sake. Chris Matthews' father was in town, and Chris Matthews got an invitation to come.
Yeah.
Well, Lou said, he was one of us. He was America.
Yeah.
He could relate to anybody. He worried that if people came out to see him, he had to see them. This goes back to Roger's point about all the reading. I had the privilege of being in the limo with him many, many times. He had heard a story that as the limousine kept going through crowds, Jimmy Carter, when he was president, never looked up. And Reagan said, if people spend the time to line up to see their president, I need to wave back at them. And so the limousine was catching everybody because we saw the president and he waved at us. Oh my God, he's a real person. And that built the momentum.
Can I ask?
Lou's got a great insight in terms of how his 8 years as governor of California helped prepare him. Because many in the audience who are younger may not remember the situation that he inherited when he came in.
Right.
We'd had 52 hostages held in Tehran for 444 days, and this had preoccupied the country. During the previous 24 months, between January of 1974 and December of 1980, the consumer price index had increased at 25%. It was the only 2 years of back-to-back double-digit inflation we had. We not only had rising inflation, but rising unemployment. Economists had previously told us this wasn't possible. There was this wonderful thing called the Phillips curve, which postulated an inverse relationship between inflation and other unemployment. And now we had the worst of both worlds, rising inflation, rising unemployment. The prime interest rate in December 1980 hit 21.5%. Mortgage interest rates were 17.5%. I mean, most presidents feel like they're dealt a difficult hand when they come into office, but I mean, he had an extraordinarily challenging situation. And I was in the meetings with him at the beginning. Remember Alan Greenspan giving him a briefing on the economy and telling him that it was absolutely worse. It was worse than he had thought it was. And I watched Reagan very carefully, and he didn't look worried. He didn't look anxious. He didn't look overwhelmed. He gave evidence of somebody who was comfortable being in the situation of dealing with difficulty, because he had a set of principles that he had developed over the course of a lifetime that he believed in and that he was going to follow. When you're around someone who is confident without being arrogant, it translates into the people who are around them. And he gave a set of people who were working around him, who were obviously much younger than he was, a degree of confidence that he knew how to lead. And the country was not there. I mean, Ken deserves partially the credit since he was the last chief of staff. But Ronald Reagan left office with an approval rating 12 percentage points higher than when he came in. Most presidents have an approval rating that declines over time, and his actually went up during that period.
There's a great irony to that. The irony is that Reagan had campaigned a good chunk of his adult life against government, and people had a higher opinion of government when he left office because so much of what we think about government is associated with what we think about the President of the United States. I just want to say one other thing. I just don't want it to get lost here because I think it's an important thing. And even though we all up here know it's important, I've written about it, I tend to forget it. Reagan did a couple of things right away that were very important. One thing he did that because Reagan never had a majority, you know, he never had a majority in the House of Representatives entire.
That's right.
And he needed, and that meant he needed every Republican. He needed a unity. And one of the reasons he got,
there were 27.
A couple of reasons he got unity besides this guy, who was a very superior at his job. The first way he got unity was he united the Republican Party, I think, in a moment when he put George H.W. Bush on the ticket. I think it was something that I wrote about, believed he was going to do, and was glad he did it, and I think it really helped him. The other thing he did, this has never before happened in the history of the Republic, and I'll bet it It may happen again, but I wouldn't put a large amount of money on it. He chose, you talk about a team of rivals, and he chose the chief of staff of his opponent, his last two opponents. I mean, Jim Baker, who I think was the best White House chief of staff that I know of,
except
was
Ken Duberstein.
I'm
a Baker boy.
So. Yeah, Kenny was a great chief of staff, and he was great at everything he did. But Baker was in a situation where he is all of a sudden representing the guy who had defeated his guy, and Baker did a lot of things. But the thing that always impressed me was that he said, and Kenny will catch me up on this if I'm wrong, but Baker said he never let a call from a member of Congress go unreturned on the same day, and that's pretty remarkable. Now you have to, you also, in this life, it's who you follow and who follows you, and he was following Carter, and there were an awful lot of those guys who never gotten a phone call, Democrats I'm talking about, never got a phone call from Jimmy Carter. And
not only returning their phone calls, it was making them.
Yeah, and so here's this guy all of a sudden who is communicating with the people who, after all, are going to have to pass this budget. And if you go back, and I know the fact that Reagan was almost killed in this terrible day on March 30th had something to do with it, but if you go back and look at what all of us were writing in the Washington Post, let alone what they were writing in the New York Times and Time and Newsweek and all everybody else, there didn't seem to be much chance at the beginning of 1981 that any of that stuff was going to be passed, and it was really quite something what they did. I mean, to get every Republican on board, to reach out to Congress that way, to have people like Kenny talking to Democrats and Republicans, and then Reagan reaching out to the country. That was, if you look back at it in history, and you look at what it looked like at the beginning of the year and the way it came out, it's quite an extraordinary performance.
We had 191 Republicans. Ronald Reagan understood that in order to be an effective president, he had to win on Capitol Hill, which meant keeping every Republican vote and adding at least 27. We thought we had a pool of about 80, and from that we could draw people. One of the things that we did, beside the big speeches and the great communicator, and responding to all the congressional phone calls, was we figured out, and Bart Stupak will know this and appreciate this, we used to ask the president to call the congressman back home in his district. Because if you call the congressman in his district office, it's a big deal. If you call on Capitol Hill, oh, it's the White House calling. But all of a sudden, it's chatter back home in the district. What did the president want? Oh, we asked you for your vote on what? Oh, you're going to give Reagan a break? And all of a sudden, it starts building up that kind of interest and that kind of
character. Ken, you may remember, in connection with that, you may remember that you guys used to give him a list of people to call, and typically call them on their birthday, among other things. And
or anniversaries, or kids' birthdays, right. Or whatever.
And this was after he had been shot, and he was still recuperating, and he had not yet made a public speech. I think you'll remember this story. And there was a congressman from Pennsylvania who was in his district.
Eugene Atkinson.
Exactly. Right. And the president doesn't phone these people. The White House operators call and get them on the phone. And then the president comes on the line, and the White House operators tracked this member of Congress down, who happened to be on a call-in radio program, but that was not apparent. And so the first words that Americans heard that the president, after he had been shot, had spoken, were in this conversation that he was having with a member of Congress where he was congratulating him on his birthday and wishing him well, et cetera.
So the governing part of that, the governing part of that is that the first contact with Eugene Atkinson took place during transition, where somebody on my staff went to visit him and pointed out that Reagan had won 62% of his district.
Right.
And he said, look, I want to be helpful to the president on the budget. As Bart knows, saying you want to be helpful in the budget and voting for it are two different things. But we at least thought we had a shot. And so we went back, and then the president, with the assassination attempt, and he was making phone calls. And if you talk about Reagan and the luck of the Irish, little did we know that it was a live radio call-in show that was recorded. And somehow Sheila and the press operation got that recording to every network. And so everybody in America, the first time they really heard President Reagan's voice was talking to a congressman asking for his help on the budget.
In his pajamas.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. I want you to clarify something that's now talked about quite a bit, which is the relationship between the president and Tip O'Neill in the context of Washington now, where there's so little genuine interaction between presidents of one party and members of Congress of the other. People say all the time they would get together and drink. Did they often? Did it happen 10 times?
St. Patrick's Day.
How often did it happen? How many drinks did they have?
Reagan would always finally say, it's 6 o'clock, we can be friends again.
Tip O'Neill would call him at different times and say, is it 6 o'clock?
Right, exactly.
It's always 6 o'clock for you.
I remember a lunch that we had for Tip on his birthday with Jim Baker, Mike Deaver, the president, and myself. And the two of them, for 2 hours, told old Irish stories. And Mike finally said, well, the two of you got to get back to running the country. And Tip said, oh, I got one more. So Reagan wasn't going to leave it. And it went on for another almost hour.
But
during the whole lunch, the only thing that Baker, Deaver, or I said was, don't you guys have to go back to work? Now, the trick was, when you wanted them to negotiate with one another, it had to be all pre-cooked. Because philosophically, they were so far removed that if you left any wiggle room, they would be two old Irishmen and they'd start yelling at one another, even in the Oval Office. And I have this great memory of David Stockman, who was the OMB director, encouraging Tip to come down. We had a meeting, and Tip said something, and Reagan flared, and Tip flared, and Stockman, no, I can take care of it, I can handle it, I can find the magic asterisk, I can make this thing work. So the relationship was one of friendship, even though there were philosophical differences.
There was
one more little thing. The night before we invaded Grenada, we had a secret briefing upstairs in the residence. We had the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, the Secretary of Defense, et cetera, and made the compelling case why we needed to do this. And this was in light of the Marines who had been killed in the barracks in Lebanon. And I will never forget, the meeting concluded, and there was Tip O'Neill. Everybody got up, and Tip went like this, God bless you, Mr. President. God bless America. And if you don't think we stood as one that day, that's what's missing today. And here is the Speaker of the House, liberal Democrat, Massachusetts, Ronald Reagan, California governor, now president, derided by many people. And they came together and said, God bless you, Mr. President. That's what's missing, I think, in the political system today, that coming together. Excuse me.
No, that's the right story. Tip gave Reagan a lot of help in Lebanon. It wasn't just right. Doing anything. I mean, I say this as a critic of the whole deployment, so I'm not overjoyed by what I'm saying, but I don't think we would have been able to sustain that deployment without Tip. And the only thing Tip ever wanted was was to be ambassador to Ireland, and Reagan was perfectly willing to give it to him, but by the time he offered it to him, as you'll remember, Kenny, Millie was too sick. And I think this is about Ronald Reagan, but Tip O'Neill brought an awful lot to the table, folks. What we're lacking today Tip O'Neill always put the United States of America first. He never put his party first. I had many conversations with Tip about different things. Tip said, "Oh, you're up there covering that Reagan," But Tip always, despite all of his partisan reputation he had, He looked at the big picture as far as our country was concerned, and to me, you want different kind of leadership in the White House maybe, but I also want a different kind of leadership in Congress. I want Tip O'Neill back.
Yeah, let me just add to that. The other relationship which people don't know about is the relationship between the Kennedy family, and here we are at the IOP and in at the Kennedy Forum, and the Reagans. The first phone call I received when President Reagan died was from Ted Kennedy, who wanted me to convey to Nancy how much the whole family had respected and remembered Ronald Reagan for what he did for the country and what he did for the Kennedy family. The Kennedys had not been in the White House for the 4 years of Jimmy Carter, and within the first couple of months, the Reagans invited the Kennedys in. When the Kennedy Library was raising money, it was Ronald Reagan who went to Teddy's home in McLean to host a fundraiser and be the headline of it. And as Teddy said to me, you know, Ronald Reagan sometimes didn't remember your name, but he always remembered his goals. That's a hell of an epitaph. Excuse me.
Well, the Kennedys were pretty good haters, is probably being, as well as being the number one political family in America, and people that I admired, and I, as a Catholic, I've been raised to think that nobody Catholic could ever be president. That was one of the greatest moments in my life when John F. Kennedy was elected. But when Carter was president, a lot of people have forgotten this, but I'll bet you no Kennedy has ever forgotten it. The Congress had this struck this medal for the Ethel Kennedy. And President Carter, for reasons on my political comprehension, never refused to award this medal. And I don't know who it was. I think it was Deaver who told, Kennedy would know, Deaver who told Reagan about it. And Reagan said immediately, oh, let's do it. Let's have a ceremony and award the medal. And I was at that ceremony, and Frank Mankiewicz and all kinds of people who have believed me over the years had said so many bad things about Reagan, had never had a good word for Reagan, came over to me. Well, he said, like I had something to do with this. Your guy, he says, may not be what we want as a president, but he's a big-hearted man, and he knows what to do. And no Kennedy has ever forgotten that. And Reagan grasped it. But the curious thing is, I don't think Reagan really did it for political advantage at all. I think Reagan did it because he thought it was the right thing to do.
Let me stop. I want to ask Sheila a question, then we're going to go to questions from the audience. The story between the president and the first lady, incredible personal story and a huge part of his time in public life. What, in the presidency, what did he rely on Nancy Reagan for from the official parts of the job? What kind of advice, what kind of situations did he turn to her?
He turned to Roger for policy advice, and he did not turn to Nancy Reagan for that. Nancy Reagan, I think, my evaluation is that her greatest value to him was the antenna she had for the people around him.
Right.
And if somebody was pursuing an agenda that was in conflict with or not helpful to the president in some way, she would not be happy. And it might take some time, but she would begin to discuss that with him. And it's that kind of influence that I saw her have over the time I was with her.
The other part to that is Ronald Reagan trusted everybody.
Yeah.
And Nancy was the verifier.
Yeah.
That's the way it works.
Yeah. Her famous comment about Ronald Reagan, he liked the sound of chief but not of staff, as soon as I heard Nancy say that, I knew Don Reagan. I didn't know how it was going to happen, but I knew Don Reagan wasn't going to be White House
Chief of Staff. Well, let me tell you,
I want you to know, I returned every one of her phone calls. I loved it.
I knew he wasn't going to last when I sat next to him at a dinner, and he'd been there a year, and he said, you know, I don't know. He says, you know, Nancy Reagan calls all the time, and he said, I've decided, he says, I like your idea of this. He says, I was thinking about hiring one of her friends from California to come and take the calls. And I thought, your days are numbered.
Well,
that's not the way it works.
Yes. And when, Sheila was absolutely right. When I was chief of staff, sometimes she would call once a day and sometimes 10 times a day. I found her as my best ally because she gave me a reading on him. And there are some times, frankly, that I would call her and ask her to weigh in, that I wanted him to see a picture that I couldn't provide. And if she agreed, she was willing to do it. But the idea of the two of them, he was always better when she was in the equation. And she was always better when he was there.
And the probably the last most important point on the whole relationship, she took a lot of criticism for being overprotective of him, for watching his schedule. The staff tended to crowd it, and she tried to slow it down because she knew the pace that he operated best. And I observed later that years later, when he was dying, Nancy Reagan was doing exactly the same thing. She protected him from any unnecessary stresses or issues the way she always did, and suddenly the press got it. You know, they figured it out. That had always been her role, and nothing had changed.
Let me ask, it was a
true love affair.
Ask people who want to ask questions in the audience. There's a microphone there and a microphone there. Please go ahead and start lining up while people line up and formulate their questions. Roger, I'm going to ask you just one big rapid round gimmicky question. One way the current president is most like Ronald Reagan and the way he's least like Ronald Reagan.
Well. He's like Ronald Reagan in that he came into the job without ever having experience in the executive branch of the federal government. And in that respect, it's a big job. And if you haven't worked there before or haven't seen it up close, it can be a little overwhelming. The way in which I think they are similar, and I only know this at a distance because I don't have the kind of insight inside the Obama White House, but the impression that I have is that he trusts the people around him in the same way that President Reagan grew to trust the people who had the opportunity to work around him. It is very clear that he trusted almost everybody, almost to a fault in certain cases, and I think the First Lady was a real asset to him in terms of helping to create a sense of reality there. But he had a great capacity and was willing to trust the people around him.
We're going to go to audience questions. As always, standard rules apply. Identify yourself. Ask a short question that's actually a question. No speech or declarations of candidacy.
Great. Hi, my name is Ariella. I'm a sophomore in the college. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about the legacy of President Reagan. Many politicians today try and make the claim that they, in fact, embody his legacy, and I see that often mislabeled. So I'm wondering if you could speak to both sides, namely a claim that you've seen that might be mislabeled as such, and also a genuine claim and what you see as the true legacy of the president.
Lou?
Ronald Reagan's greatest legacy is that he and Gorbachev together gave us a safer world. We had the power to destroy each other's countries. It's a Soviet official, Alexander Bezmertnik, who said the experts didn't believe, but the leaders did. They both worried about accidental nuclear war. They worked together. It trivializes what their accomplishment to say who was more important than the other. They neither could have done it without the other. That's the most important legacy. As Alan Brinkley says about, Doug Brinkley says about Abraham Lincoln, we don't remember whether or not he balanced the budget. You know, we remember that he saved the Union and freed the slaves. What we're going to remember about Ronald Reagan is he made the country strong, but he made the country strong for a purpose, a means to the end of making us less dependent on nuclear arsenals and nuclear war.
Sheila, one of the most enduring legacies of President Reagan is, to this day, Republicans seeking national office talk about President Reagan more than any other and put themselves forward as someone who will be an heir to the Reagan legacy. Who have you seen, to follow up on the question, who have you seen since Ronald Reagan left office who you think is most obvious heir to what he stood for, what his legacy was?
Well, George Bush Sr. was campaigned on continuing the Reagan legacy. I think that I'm not going to fall for that trap because I don't really. I think that
it was a friendly trap.
I know. I think
that. But a trap nonetheless.
That Reagan's leadership and strength derived from his character, and I don't think we have seen anyone of that specific kind of character. He was a man who was larger than life, and a lot of even to the people around him. You had a sense when you were with him that you were with a very unusual and special person, and he had the trust of the American people. And I think that's the kind of thing people have to aspire to. They can't claim to have.
Okay, question here.
None of the above. And one of the things that I think bothers some of us is that he's being appropriated by the far left and by the far right. And the answer is Ronald Reagan was a doer and a pragmatist. Baker and I and others and Deaver may have been accused of not letting Reagan be Reagan, but as Lou will point out, as he did often in his columns, Reagan was the ultimate pragmatist and the person who sometimes we had to hold back. But remember, he was president of the Screen Actors Guild, so he learned how to negotiate.
I would share Lou's view that transforming the relationship with the Soviet Union was an enormous lasting legacy.
And it almost, the key Berlin Wall speech almost didn't get done because the State Department objected to language in the speech. And no,
he's the one who wrote it in.
Peter Robinson wrote it, and the State Department wanted it out.
Reagan kept it in.
And I went to him, and he asked me, and I said, I thought it was a hell of a line. And he said, let me look at it, and read it, and said, I think we'll leave it in. On the day as we drove to the Brandenburg Gate, he was rehearsing the speech one more time. And no matter how good of a great communicator he was reading it, even though he was going to do it on teleprompter. And we got to that section, and he said, it's going to drive the State Department boys crazy, but I'm going to leave it in. And 20 minutes later, tear down this wall, Mr. Gorbachev. He was that kind of a bold stroke, primary color leader.
Okay, question here.
Good evening. My name is Matt Shiraki. I'm a graduate student here at the Kennedy School. First, I want to thank you for being here. Also, wanted to thank the forum staff for putting this great event on. Mr. Cannon, you've written in your books about how when you go back to Illinois and you check the records, how every house that the Reagan family moved to in succession got lower and lower income, it was smaller. And I was wondering, just given his own personal upbringing, his personal roots and challenges, I was wondering if each of you could comment on the role that President Reagan's personal life, what kind of a role and what kind of dynamic that had in the way he viewed his presidency and the way he treated each of you and how it shaped his policy agenda.
Very big topic.
Well, I'm going to try a very quick answer, which is not, that's a much better question than my answer will be. Reagan, the line which everybody in this stage will remember, Reagan used to say that we didn't live on the wrong side of the tracks, but we lived close enough to the tracks to hear the whistle. Right. And Reagan had he had made his way in difficult times, you know. He was always an optimist about getting a job when people weren't getting jobs. And I think that was both his strength and a weakness of him. The strength of it was that Reagan was always believed that you would get ahead in this country. He always believed that the future was going to be better than the past. The weakness was that sometimes it didn't leave him with enough appreciation with the people who couldn't make it as he had done. But the other thing I want to say, I think the best thing that has been said up here tonight has been said by Sheila. I think that Reagan's strength was in his character. And Reagan's character was enormous. I mean, the only, you know, we had a long relationship. He didn't say very many personal things to me. He did say once to me, out of the blue, and it surprised me so much I didn't know what to say, that he thought that one of the reasons that I was interested in him was because I also had an alcoholic father who also happened to be named Jack and, you know, had a similar background. And I don't know why he said that. I don't know why he knew it. It was certainly true. And it's very hard for those of you who've had the experience, I'm sure there's many in the audience who have, of being the child of an alcoholic. That's a struggle. And being the child of a nomadic alcoholic who moves around, Reagan never, he started a different grade in every one of the reasons Nancy Reagan believes this is the reason for his the distance that he kept, that he didn't have any friends except his brother as a boy, because you're in a different school every year. To overcome all of this stuff and to do achieve, suppose he had been president. To be this, he was a terrific sportscaster. He was an actor just below the rank of top star. He was a host of a television program that had for 7 years the highest ratings on Sunday, and he was governor of the most populous state. If he hadn't become president, that would be an enormous an achievement, you know. And he became president of the United States as well. So this is a guy who really learned from, and he had a lot to learn from. And he did not have an easy row of it.
Yes.
My name is Sophie Fry. I'm a sophomore at the college. On a slightly different track, if President Reagan was here today and looking at the Republican candidates for 2012, who do you think he would endorse and why?
Because he wouldn't. He didn't believe in endorsing in primaries.
Correct.
Who would he want?
Well, he wouldn't endorse.
But I know. But who would be his choice?
He would not endorse nor select.
Well, he wanted George H.W. Bush, even though he didn't endorse him. And I don't know that's a good question. Who do you think, Roger? We were talking about this over a drink. Not Roger, he doesn't drink. But we were still talking about it over a drink.
I drink.
I was sober.
Roger, wade right in. Who would he secretly be for if the Republicans out there?
I actually think that he wouldn't get involved. I think this was not an act. I just think he had this 11th commandment, speak no ill of another Republican, and I don't think he would have leapt in. I do share the view that's been expressed, that at bottom, he was very much a pragmatist, and that he would look for someone who had the kind of qualities that he thought he had. And that Sheila encapsulated wonderfully in her definition of him as a character.
Beliefs.
But he had a core set of beliefs, yeah. And you always had the sense that he was grounded.
Yeah.
And it made a huge difference in debates and discussions, because there are always going to be people who are going to be differing with one another, that there was someone there who had a core set of beliefs, and you knew what they were.
We're doing a spectacularly bad job of answering your question.
No.
It's clear.
I'm giving you an honest answer. He would not have endorsed. He wouldn't have been selected. He would have had hands off. But no. Lou's comment about the television program for 7 years, GE Theater, reminds me of a wonderful story. In the dusk in New Jersey, in a small country road, we were campaigning in 1988. We came around a corner in the limo, and there was this old lady with a big sign, and it said, "We loved you in GE Theater days, but we love you more as our president." And I pointed it out to Reagan, and I said, "That's the best sign, handmade sign, I've ever seen about you." And Reagan says, "Second best." Ohio State University, 1984 campaign, 10,000 students. He's old, but he's cute.
question up there.
Hi, I'm Josh Archambault. I graduated from the Kennedy School last year. Thank you so much for being here. I wondered if you could speak a little bit about his legacy once he left office. We see President Carter and President Clinton trying to build their legacy now. What could other future presidents learn from those around him, what he did, what they say about building your own legacy once you've left office?
Well, Alzheimer's deprived him of the opportunity, I think, to build the post-presidential legacy. That's my view.
Yeah.
In the first year, he was very religious about not commenting on his successor, which is George Bush. He thought any president successor has to have his time in office. And by the time he was, I think, thinking about commenting, it's the onset of Alzheimer's. But he was always very, very proud of George Herbert Walker Bush and the job he was doing as president.
Good, thank you. There, up there.
Hi, I'm John Soda. I'm a freshman at the college from Turkey. I have a question about the Cold War. I think we sort of got at this a little bit. Many people say Reagan won the Cold War, and you know, others say, well, Reagan didn't win, the Soviets lost. I was just gonna ask for your stance on that, and if you think, I was wondering whether you could explain his role in bringing the end of the Cold War.
Let me tell you a story that took place in Governor's Island in New York Harbor in December 1988, where President Reagan brought President-elect Bush along to meet with Mikhail Gorbachev. Ceremonial passing of the torch. 7 Americans, 7 Russians. Gorbachev was in New York at the United Nations. He started the lunch off by expressing concern that his policies of glasnost and perestroika might not work, and they were being thwarted by the then bureaucracy, the nomenklatura in the then Soviet Union, and he didn't know whether or not it would succeed. And he turned to President Reagan almost as an older brother and said, what insight do you have? And Ronald Reagan, could have been GE Theater days, said, the bureaucracy is the same the world over. And Mr. General Secretary, the only way you can overcome the bureaucracy is to get the people on your side. And the only way you can get the people on your side is less money for missiles and more for consumer goods. Less money for the military and more for housing. And you could see in Gorbachev's eyes that either way he turned, he was screwed. Because either he alienated the military or he couldn't get the civilians. To me, that may have been the moment in my way, not the Berlin Wall, where I realized that what Reagan was saying was fundamentally the end of the then Soviet Union.
Mr. Gorbachev has said on many occasions that we all won the Cold War, and I agree with him.
Time for one last quick question and answer, Robin, please.
Great. Mark Gunderson. I'm a student across the river at the business school. Question, it was mentioned, earlier that Ronald Reagan was a very spiritual person, didn't wear it on his sleeve, but it's something that I haven't heard talked about as much. I'm just curious what those who had kind of personal interactions with him observed of his faith and if, you know, if that was an important part of his life.
I think he was far more religious in thinking and doing after the assassination attempt.
How did it manifest itself?
Well, he said, in fact, he said afterwards that he believed he'd been spared for a reason, and that whatever time was left to him, he was devoting to the good of the country, and I mean, he clearly was touched spiritually by it, and talk about an example of a man's great leadership. The way he handled the aftermath of that assassination attempt was amazing. I mean, I stood in the hospital corridor when he was going into surgery, and he lifted the mask, and standing right across were Baker, Deaver, and Meese, this morose looks on their face. They're looking down like this. And he looks up and he said, who's minding the store? And that was the beginning of a series of jokes. Then he gets in the operating room and he says to the doctors, I hope you're all Republicans.
Right.
That was really happening
and
to this guy.
And the doctor's answer was, Today we're all Republicans.
Right. and that gave him moral authority, but it also,
right.
he said, geez, what was that guy's beef? You know, that was the way he wanted to know what happened. He was very spiritual, and I know they had services at Camp David, but he really didn't like the idea of going in public and disturbing everybody else's experience.
Right. He always had a spiritual side to him. His mother was, Nell was a very spiritual woman. She was also a great theatrical person, funny. She dressed up. She taught. They're not just as conservative and pragmatist. They're not opposites. Being religious, you know, and having fun are not opposites either. And she was a fun-loving woman, but she believed that everything happened for a purpose. And believe me, long before the assassination attempt, when I was first interviewing Reagan, if I had a $10 bill for every time Reagan said that everything happened for a purpose, I would be independently wealthy because he really believed that. It's a Christian doctrine, and Reagan was, but he didn't want to convert you. He didn't want to go out and proselytize you. He didn't want to bother with your religion.
He would not do it in public, but as Ken pointed out, he had this very interesting relationship with Mikhail Gorbachev. And one of the things that's now been revealed about one of the summits that he had is that Reagan took about half of his time to lecture Mikhail Gorbachev on the importance of religious freedom in the Soviet Union. And that if you were going to have a successful society, it had to be based on the opportunity that people had to worship freely. And when he took the victory lap, the so-called victory lap, about a year after leaving office and went to Berlin and went to Rome and et cetera, when he went to Russia, first went to St. Petersburg and went to a church there. And it was full of worshipers, not just the old, but many of the young. And then when he went to Moscow and met with Gorbachev, he again urged him to do everything he could to establish a greater freedom of religion in Russia.
Let me conclude with a story. President Reagan was convinced that there was Christianity in Mikhail Gorbachev's background. The agency always said no. They could find no indication of it. At Governor's Island, in response to a question from George Herbert Walker Bush, the answer that Gorbachev gave was only Jesus Christ knows the answer to this story, to that question.
The budget.
And Colin Powell and I looked at each other and said, aha, okay? So when we left the meeting, I called somebody at the agency and said, Reagan's right. And they said, oh no, it's a slang expression used in the Soviet Union. Doesn't mean anything. 3 years ago, maybe four, I was in London, and I picked up a copy of the International Herald Trib, and Gorbachev had been in church and said he was renewing his Christian vows. And I said to myself, if Reagan were only alive today, he knew it. He was right.
Ken, thank you. Okay. I want to thank all four panelists helping us to this important year.
Thank you.
To try to bring President Reagan alive. Thank you all for coming and to the forum staff for putting it on. We appreciate it. Good night.
Oh my God. I know. Right.